Right at the end of the year, smart home enthusiasts got an early Christmas present with a massive announcement from Apple, Google, and Amazon. They're working together on a single smart home standard called the Project Connected Home over IP, or CHIP. After reading the news, this was my initial reaction. But what is CHIP, and why is it such a big deal for the future of smart homes? And why should you even care? I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. If you've watched my channel with any regularity, you know two things about me. I like to dig into the how and the why of technologies that can impact our lives. And two, I'm a big fan of smart homes because they're far more than eye candy and smartphone parlor tricks. They can add security, accessibility, and help with energy conservation in any home. But recommending smart home gadgets and setups is tricky. I've often referred to the current state of smart home technology as being a bit of the Wild West. Every company is out for themselves, creating systems that often don't talk to a competitor system, which means consumers can often get left holding the bag. It's why I'm very selective in the gear that I recommend on this channel. The number one requirement is that it's easy to use and set up. The second requirement is that it's safe and secure. And the third is that it's cross-platform as it possibly can be. And sometimes you have to make trade-offs on that last one to ensure the first two. Well, with the announcement of CHIP, it's looking like there may be a light at the end of the tunnel. If it plays out like I hope it does, we may have all three of those items addressed going forward. The Wild West may finally be tamed. Today we have several competing standards with protocols like Zigbee, Thread, Z-Wave, Bluetooth LE, Wi-Fi, Works with Nest, Apple HomeKit, X10, Lutron. You get the idea. Each of them have their pros and their cons. Start building out your smart home with one of these technologies, but you need to branch out to another. You're going to need to use some kind of bridge device or service. And most often we're talking about hubs like SmartThings or Hubitat, or services like IFTTT, which is If This Then That. And like I said before, it's the Wild West. This makes for a very challenging user experience. CHIP is aiming to put all of that behind us. Things like Zigbee, Thread, Bluetooth, Wi-Fi aren't going anywhere, but there'll be a standard smart home communications protocol that operates amongst all of that, so the devices can seamlessly talk to each other. In theory, if you buy a CHIP-certified device from one company, it'll be able to work with another CHIP-certified device from a competitor. For instance, a smart thermostat would have a standard way to communicate temperature, humidity, and fan speed, as well as to receive commands to adjust temperature or turn the fan on and off. Nest, Ecobee, or Honeywell shouldn't matter as long as they're all CHIP-certified. One of the most interesting things to me is that at the heart of the effort is coming from the Zigbee Alliance, Apple, Google, and Amazon. Those are some of the biggest players in smart homes today. Other partners include IKEA, Legrand, SmartThings, and Silicon Labs. The last one is even more interesting because Silicon Labs owns Z-Wave, which is one of the other major smart home wireless standards today. Z-Wave, in theory, is open sourced, but Silicon Labs is the only company allowed to produce the Z-Wave wireless chips needed to make it work. It's not exactly open. A couple of days after the announcement of CHIP, Silicon Labs announced that they were opening up Z-Wave to allow competitors to manufacture Z-Wave chips. That move alone shows how massive CHIP's impact on the industry may end up being. Apple also has open source aspects of HomeKit's ADK, which is an assessment and deployment kit, which will make it easier for accessory makers to test out and experiment with HomeKit without needing to pay up front. And to quote Apple from their blog post about CHIP, "By open sourcing its HomeKit technology, Apple will be helping to jumpstart the initiative and ultimately deliver an even better experience to customers. Starting today, developers can use the HomeKit open source ADK to prototype non-commercial smart home accessories. Apple will also contribute its HomeKit accessory protocol to the working group." The siloed nature of current smart home technology has been holding it back. I hear from a lot of people that they just don't get the appeal of smart home technology. Advertisers tend to focus heavily on the "Hey look, I can turn my lights red by using my phone." And that gives the perception that smart home technology is just eye candy and doesn't provide real value. Others have been burned by buying something that requires a specific app and setup to use, and it can't talk to anything else in their house. Nobody wants to have to jump between a half dozen different apps to configure things. And the industry has finally woken up to the user experience challenges and is attempting to fix it. they'll get a lot further working together instead of trying to maintain such strict silos. This is the first smart home standard I've actually gotten excited about because of all the major players that are involved. The system is abstracting and unifying the underlying communications between the devices. That means companies like Apple, Google, and Amazon can focus on creating engaging software experiences on top of that communications layer. Devices will just work, and users will have a cohesive user experience using whatever software platform they're happiest with. Whether that's Amazon, Apple, Google, SmartThings, fill in your favorite platform here. And on the gadget side of things, it should simplify development and manufacturing. A company doesn't have to design their own light bulb or smart thermostat to work specifically with Alexa, Google, Amazon, or even SmartThings. And they don't have to necessarily create their own app just to get things up and running. They can focus on creating well-built smart home products. This, in theory, should help to commoditize those products and drive down prices. Lowering development costs will lower final product cost, and in the end, we should hopefully see a wider variety of products in the market with a lower cost and a far better user experience in setup and use. But what's the downside? I see two possible issues. First, groups like this can get bogged down in corporate politics, and infighting can slow down agreement on a final standard. So while this sounds like it's a great concept on paper, there's still a lot of details for the group to iron out. They're hoping to have a finalized chip specification out by late 2020, which is great if they can stick to that timeline. The World Wide Web Consortium took years to finalize HTML5 specification for websites. It's not exactly an apples-to-apples comparison, but standards bodies aren't known for their speed. The second problem could be that it just adds to the mess of standards that are already out there. Instead of one specification to rule them all, we just end up adding yet another. This could manifest through half-hearted adoption of the standard. And since this standardization will commoditize many smart home products like lights, some manufacturers may want to hold back certain features and functions for their proprietary systems and software. Otherwise, they could risk not standing out from the crowd. And we've seen similar issues in web standards and browsers. Browser makers want to iterate and roll out new features that aren't part of the standard yet, and developers start creating websites targeted at those browsers with non-standard HTML and CSS, which makes other browsers not appear to be fully functional. And you end up seeing websites that say things like, best viewed in Chrome. Will that happen with this? I hope not. But we'll most likely see some non-standard, half-hearted implementations along the way. Those potential pitfalls are far outweighed by the upside of this announcement. The smart home industry has needed a shakeup, something to pull the major players together in order to take smart homes truly mainstream. It'll take a year or so for the standard to be agreed upon, and a few more years to see a lot of chip-certified products hitting the market. But it's a start. The timing of this announcement couldn't be better. Wi-Fi 6 is a major leap over Wi-Fi 5, which is what we're all using today. And one of the big reasons I tend not to recommend Wi-Fi smart home gear over Zigbee or Z-Wave is that most Wi-Fi routers can't handle a lot of devices connected at once. Most routers start to choke when they hit around 50 devices, which is pretty easy when you start adding in things like light bulbs and thermostats and door locks and even more to your home. Wi-Fi 6 changes that by being able to handle 4 times the number of devices, requiring less power from each device to maintain a connection. And it's also able to communicate with 12 devices at the same time. Chip and Wi-Fi 6 strikes me as the perfect pairing. It's the chocolate and peanut butter combo that could accelerate adoption and improve the smart home experience. Does that mean we should hold off on buying gear until this stuff gets finalized? No. While there's still no information on the upgradability of current devices to the new standard, Apple, Amazon, and Google have all said that they're not deprecating old devices. Everything that works today will continue to work into the future. The chip announcement makes me even more bullish on smart home technology in general. I'm looking forward to the day when I have a smart EV charger that can coordinate with my home's battery and solar panels to optimize my charging schedule to save me money. All without me having to do anything other than plugging the car into the charger. There are so many possibilities for how these devices can coordinate to save us energy, money, and make us safer. Now, are any of you excited about the possibilities around this update? Jump into the comments and let me know. And give this video a thumbs up if you liked it and share it with your friends because it really does help support the channel. And if you think I've earned it, I hope you'll consider subscribing and hitting that notification bell to get alerts when I post new videos. Without that bell, you might miss out. And you can also check out the links in my description for some Tesla-inspired t-shirts and some great gear and discounts. They also help support the channel. As always, an extra big thank you to my 100+ Patreon supporters. Your support is really making these videos possible. Be sure to check out my Patreon page for additional details about joining the crew. And as always, thanks so much for watching. I'll see you in the next one.